Everybody, turn to your neighbor and say, good afternoon, welcome to CCF. And then tell them, wake up, gising na. Wonderful. What a joy it is to be with you again. This morning, this afternoon, I want to talk about perspective. Perspective is how you see things. How you see things is like wearing a pair of sunglasses. If you wear something that's blue, you see everything in blue. If you wear something green, you see everything in green. For example, I want to give you this statement, and then you tell me what this statement means. Understand? You must put the punctuation mark. Where do you put the punctuation mark in this statement? Woman without her man is a savage. How do you put the punctuation? If you ask the men, this is how they will put the punctuation, all right? Men, woman without her man is a savage. Now let's ask the women, how will they put the punctuation mark? Her reply, woman without her man is a savage. It all depends on perspective. You see, perspective is how you see things. It can be exactly the same thing, but you have different conclusions. For example, the shoe manufacturer sent two agents, sales agents, to a country in Africa. And the first salesman reported back with a cable message. They didn't have cell phone at that time. Bring me back home. No market for shoes. People don't wear shoes. The second salesman cabled, fantastic opportunities. Send me a lot of shoes. People need shoes. What's the difference? Answer, perspective. You all have perspective, whether you like it or not. And this is the amazing thing that I pray your children, including you, will learn. What do I mean? If you have the right perspective, you will have right thinking. And then right thinking will result in right choices. Right choices will result in right behavior. But it's all about perspective. It affects your thinking, it affects your emotion. For example, you need money. If your perspective is, God is not going to help me, I need to cheat in order to make money. Because your perspective is, God is not really active in your life. That's your perspective. And temptation comes around, you can compromise and make extra money, you will have wrong thinking, and you're going to have wrong choices. Eventually, you're going to have wrong behavior. Somebody shared this with me right after the first service. She did not like what happened to her boyfriend. Her boyfriend was not faithful. They are not yet married. So in her anger, she decided to have an affair. And she did this recently, and she's now pregnant. So her boyfriend and her came to see us. What should we do? Look at that perspective. Wrong thinking. My boyfriend had an affair. To teach him a lesson, I would have an affair. You see, choices have consequences. But many times, you focus on behavior. You need to focus on perspective. Everybody, our message today is very simple. Develop a godly perspective. Can you turn to your neighbor? Tell your neighbor. Develop a godly perspective. I want to show you a video of how many times we have wrong perspective about God. Are you ready for this nice video? All right, let's watch this.
I question the sanity of these two guys who decided to pull off an illegal urban wingsuit stunt in Rio de Janeiro. As you can see, the men were Red Bull wingsuit daredevils. They actually successfully threaded the needle between two skyscrapers in Rio. One of the daredevils attempted to fly by one of Brazil's famous monuments. Fortunately for him, that was his final stunt.
You know, many times, that's what you think of Jesus. That's what you think of God. When there's a problem, we blame God. You think God does not want you to enjoy life. Do you know, years ago, I used to have that perspective. I was afraid of the Lord. I was afraid if I give my life to the Lord, He will send me to Africa. It's crazy. When I came to know Jesus intimately, I realized if God wants me to go to Africa, I will be the happiest person in Africa. Because if I don't go to Africa and He wants me to go to Africa, but I don't obey Him, I'm going to be miserable. Because God has my best interest at heart. Perspective is everything, especially theology. What you think about God is most crucial. If you have wrong thinking about God, you're going to have wrong perspective about life. That's why the Apostle Paul dedicated a long prayer. One of the longest recorded prayer of the Apostle Paul is found in Ephesians chapter 3. And this is his prayer. He began by talking about, I pray that the eyes of your faith will be opened. But in chapter 3, he talks about this. Everybody, his prayer that you may be able, everybody read with me, that you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, length, height, and depth, to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to the fullness of God. See, to develop perspective means it's not automatic. You are not born with the right perspective. You need to develop it. And the Apostle Paul is praying that you and I will develop a godly perspective anchored on who God is, His love for us. Notice his prayer. That you'll be able to comprehend, to understand with all the saints what is the breadth, length, height, and depth, to know the love of Christ. Do you know God loves you, ladies and gentlemen? Do you know? It's one thing to know. Do you believe? He tells us, which surpasses knowledge. It is almost impossible to understand how much God loves you. You need to pray. You need to grow. And that's why I ask people, you need to develop godly perspective. Not only that, part of his prayer is this. To him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us. God wants you to know the amazing power that's available for God's people. Notice, to him, to God, who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think. Something you cannot even imagine. In fact, the Bible should have stopped, to him who is able. Is God able? Of course, but he continues. To him who is able to do far more. He could have stopped here, but he continued. God is not only able, he's not only able to do far more, what? Abundantly. He could have stopped here. He continued, far more abundantly what? Beyond. He could have stopped there. He did not stop there. God is able to do far more beyond all that we ask. He could have stopped here or think. Do you believe that God loves us and He has infinite power to surprise us with His great plans? Yes or no? But my friend, do you believe that God is on your side? That's the problem. All of us have past experiences. For example, if you grew up with a father who is irresponsible, who is abusive, and then you hear me talking about God, our Father, I can almost guess, if this is your first time in CCF and your father was abusive, in all probability, you will have a hard time relating to God as a loving father. When I became a father, I began to understand the heart of God even more. I have 5 wonderful children. I will do anything to protect them, to bless them. Why? I love them. And God spoke to me. God said, Peter, if you can love your children, how much more do I love you? My friend, you have to develop godly perspective. Everybody say that with me. Develop a godly perspective. Turn to your neighbor. Tell your neighbor, develop a godly perspective. We will look at the life of Joseph regarding his perspective on trials, his perspective on power, his perspective on success. Are you ready? All right? Look at this guy, Joseph. How in the world can he survive all the trials of his life? Imagine, betrayed by brothers. Have you ever been betrayed by people? I think all of us once upon a time will have experienced this. It's painful. But this is betrayed by brothers. That's even more painful. Sold as a slave. Have you been sold as a slave? I don't think so. He was sold as a slave. That's bad enough. How did he survive? My goodness, look at his perspective. He was faithful. And then he was falsely accused. Not just falsely accused. Because of standing up for God. Because of being righteous. He was falsely accused and he ended up in prison. Now, we have many people today who are in prison. If you ask them, they are all not guilty. Understand? But the truth is, many of them are guilty. Yes or no? But Joseph was not guilty. Yet, he survived. You know why? His perspective. He walked by faith. And the Bible tells us he was even promoted and then he was forgotten. But because of his perspective, walked by faith, anchored on who God is, the Bible tells us the day came when he was promoted prime minister. So let's learn, what does it mean to have a godly perspective? Let's talk about trials. Everybody look at me. How many of you have problems this week? Just this week alone. Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you have problems this week and this entire month, the month of November? You have at least a problem. Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you have no problem? Raise your hand. You know, sooner or later, look at me, you will have problems. Yes or no? Sooner or later, you will encounter disappointments. Just this week alone, my wife, her bag, somebody stole her bag while shopping. She lost her credit card. She lost her cell phone. She lost her license. She lost her money. But I was shocked at her perspective. She said, you know, I was thinking, I don't have any more Bible tracts inside my bag. I wanted the robber to read Bible verses. So I go, what kind of a perspective is that? You see, my wife has developed godly perspective. She does not believe in accidents. God must have a purpose. But you need to develop this. And I've discovered trials and problems always impact us. It will affect you. But not always for the good. Not always for the better. If you don't respond properly, your trials may make you bitter and not better. This message is crucial, especially for Christians, especially young Christians. After giving your life to Jesus, you may have this idea. If I'm walking with God, I should not have problems. And if I have problems, it's because God does not love me. Look at me. God loves you, yes or no? But if he allows problems, there must be a reason. That's called godly perspective. So let's look at Joseph. The Bible tells us in chapter 45, verse 5, now do not be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. God sent me before you to preserve life. Notice his perspective. Do not be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. Joseph was acknowledging what they did was bad. You sold me. In Tagalog, binenta po ninyo ako. Linoko ninyo ako. However, What's the perspective? God is involved. You see, to have godly perspective, you have to know who God is. You have to know His power. You have to know His intention. God is always involved in the lives of His people. And Joseph said, "You sold me? Relax. You are responsible. I know. God was involved." Perspective is crucial. Look at the next verse. "God sent me before you." Notice, God is involved. "To preserve for you a remnant in the earth, to keep you alive by a great deliverance." God is involved all the time. That is the meaning of perspective. Do you see God in the midst of your problem? This is so crucial. Look at what the New Testament has to say. In 1 Peter, Peter was writing to the believers scattered all over Turkey. And Peter said, "In this you greatly rejoice." Notice, not just rejoice. Louder? No, that's crazy. "In this you greatly rejoice." Rejoice over what? Everybody read. "Even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials." Look at his perspective on trials. You are to rejoice. Not just rejoice. Rejoice greatly. How in the world can you do that? Notice his perspective on trials. "Though for a little while," all trials are temporal. Look at me. Sooner or later, those trials will soon be over. "It too shall pass away." Say that with me. "It too shall pass away." But trials have a purpose. For him, what's the purpose? If necessary, notice, if necessary, meaning God does not give you unnecessary trial. Only when it is necessary. Why? Let's find out. What is the divine perspective? Everybody read. "So that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." Let's analyze this verse. Perspective. "So that the proof of your faith," the word proof, the genuineness of your faith. Apparently, some faith are not real. Some faith are counterfeit. But the guy does not know it. You don't know whether your faith is genuine or not. Why is that important? "It's more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire." He is saying the genuineness of your faith is so crucial. Let me tell you why it is crucial. If somebody does not believe in God, if somebody does not believe in Jesus, at least he knows he's antichrist. He does not need Christ. In his mind, he knows. But if somebody goes to church, if somebody comes to places like this, and they don't fully understand the gospel, they think they are Christians. But in reality, their faith is not genuine. God is saying, better know now whether your faith is genuine or not. And it will be shown when you are tested. When your faith is challenged, when problems come upon your life, you will tell whether you continue to trust God or your faith is shallow, your faith is commercial, and then you turn away from the Lord. God is saying, it's better you find out now than find out too late. You know, many people will get the shock of their life someday as they stand before God. And then Jesus will give them the most shocking statement I have discovered in the Gospel of Matthew, when Jesus said, "Depart from me, I never," what? "I never knew you." Then they say, "Lord, Lord, did we not pray? Did we not cast out demons in your name? Did we not do a lot of miracles?" And Jesus will say, "I never knew you." That's why don't be afraid of trials. It is to refine your faith. To make sure, everybody read this, "so that the proof of your faith." Now let me ask you, is your faith in Christ genuine or not? That's why God allows trials to mold us, to make us understand our need for Jesus. And that's why he tells us, everybody read this, let those who suffer according to the will of God entrust their souls to a faithful Creator in doing what is right. Sometimes you don't know why you have problems. Your only recourse is to what? Let's read this together. Let those who suffer according to the will of God, no exemptions at times. We all go through pain. Entrust, read this together one more time. Entrust their souls to a faithful Creator. Your perspective of God must be so clear that God is faithful. When He allows you to have problems, it is not to destroy you. It is to build you up. So I put it in my mind. It's called, are you ready? It's called suspense fire. I have a suspense fire in my mind. When I don't understand what's happening, I am afraid to judge God. I'm afraid to judge people. I put that in a suspense fire. Meaning, Lord, I surrender this to you. I don't know why, but I know you. Someday, I trust you will make it clear. In the meantime, I will trust you. I put it under what file? Suspense file. I do that with my friends. I remember one time calling somebody. He did not answer me. Now, I have a couple of conclusions. Galit na sa akin ito. Does he want to answer me? Listen to me. If you called my wife this week and my wife did not respond to you, you know why? Don't jump. Put it in the suspense file. You talk to her. Mrs. Tanchi, how come you did not answer me? She will tell you, ano ka ba? Nawala ang bago. Of course, she won't say that, okay? She will say, I lost my cell phone. You know how my wife is. How can I call you back? I lost my cell phone. Understand? Suspense file. Don't judge people quickly. If you don't understand something, don't judge God. What do you say? Lord, I entrust to you. I don't know why. Do you understand? So everybody, turn to your neighbor, tell your neighbor, develop godly perspective. And you know what's a godly perspective? When you are depressed, when you're discouraged, read this, everybody. Psalm 27, verse 13. I would have despaired unless I had believed I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Many times, I would have despaired. This is very true to my life. I've encountered various trials. Remember, I'm the only few people in the whole world that has been kicked out of his own company. Understand? It's hard to get kicked out of your own company. But I was kicked out. It's very hard to be betrayed by friends. I was betrayed. It's very hard to realize how in the world will I find bread for my family. Understand? Some of you probably relate to this. But one thing I can tell you, let's read this one more time. I would have despaired unless what? I believe that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Many people spiritualize everything. Yes, I believe the best is yet to come, next life to come. But I also believe that you can see the goodness of the Lord right now while you are still alive in the land of the living. You know why? Because God is good and faithful. Now, I know there are times like that testimony of Jim, how people died, killed by those radicals. It's hard for me to explain. I put that under suspense file. God will make everything clear. In the meantime, do you believe God is good? Louder. Or I tell your neighbor, God is good. All the time? No, you must say God is good. God is good. All the time? You know? So easy to say, right? God is good all the time. All right. Now, when you have a problem, can you say God is good or you say God is bad sometime? My friend, develop a godly perspective. Anchored on who God is. his prayer that you will comprehend the love of God. God loves you, and you'll comprehend his power that's available for your life. And then what must you do? Look at the next verse. Wait for the Lord. Be strong. Let your heart take courage. Yes, wait for the Lord. You see, when I have a suspense file, I wait expectantly. I say, Lord, I don't know why. I'm going to trust you. That's the idea. I've asked my wife to share with us some of her perspectives, especially when it comes to problems. Can you please welcome my one and only baby wife?
Good afternoon. I'm going to share a story with you that happened to me a number of years ago. You see, when our children were young, it had been quite a while since I had been able to visit my family in the States. And so my dear husband said, you know, Deanna, you can go and visit your family and I'll take care of the children. And so I left and flew to New York, very excited to see my family. But when I arrived in New York, our plane was delayed, so I was waiting in the terminal. And this old guy came by and he kind of bent down and looked like he was picking up something. And I didn't really notice him that much. But a little while later, when I checked my bag, my wallet was gone. It's another wallet story. And I had lost all my money that I was going to have for the trip. So I found a quarter in my bag, and I called my dad, and I said, Dad, I'm coming home, but I don't have any money. And my father said, it's okay, Deanna, don't worry. I'll take care of you. So I had a great vacation with my family, and my father even gave me $100 to buy gifts for our kids and his grandkids. So I was excited to go home, and I had three big suitcases. Never travel with three big suitcases, okay? It was a bad decision. Well, when I was about to leave, my father said, Deanna, I can give you some more money. I said, no, Dad, it's okay. I have around $24, and I'm just going straight home, so no problem, I thought. So when I arrived in LA Airport, when I went to the check-in counter, China Airline, I wasn't on the passenger list. They couldn't find my name. And so I remember just standing there and praying, Lord, you're all I have. I have no money. You're all I have. Please take care of me. Do something. And then in a short while, they called my name, and they said, well, you're on the passenger list. We got you on the airplane. So I said, well, great. Thank you. Then I brought my three bags up to the counter, and the guy said, I'm sorry, but you are $90 overweight. Your bags, not you. So... And I said, oh my, I don't have money to pay. And I told him my money had been stolen. And he said, okay, I'll pay for you. And I said, no, you can't pay for me. I won't see you again. And so I remembered praying, Lord, you're all I have. Can you do something? And then I went back up to him and I said, well, is there any other way that I can get my bag on the airplane? Well, he said, well, yes, actually there is. If there's a person here who just has one bag and they're willing to take your other bag on as their second bag, then you can get your bag on for free. And so I thought, okay, thank you. So I started interviewing people. So I went to them and said, where are you going? And how many bags do you have? And, you know, finally this one lady got really upset with me. And she said, why are you asking that question? And I felt like crying. So I stood again by my bags and I cried, Lord, you're all I have. Can you do something, please? And then the guy at the counter called me again. He said, Mrs. Tanchi, I have good news. There was a guy who was going to fly to Taiwan. To Japan. But he suddenly decided to get off in Taiwan, and he's willing to take your bag. And I thought, Lord, you touched his heart. Thank you. He was the father of the girl who had gotten mad at me, and he didn't even know his daughter got mad. God touched his heart. So now I was on the plane flying to Taiwan, so happy that God had solved all my... Oh, no. Oh, sorry. I forgot something very important. I went back to get my bags. I had three, right? I counted. One, two. My bag with all the toys in it was missing. It was gone. And I remember I went back to the same guy at the counter and said, you won't believe what happened. My bag is gone. He said, well, what does it look like? And I explained it. It was a blue bag. It had toys inside. And at that time, the bags went up from behind the counter. There was a hole and the bags went up a trolley or something. He climbed up that hole and he came back with my bag. And he found my bag. It had been tagged for Air France, but I was on China Airlines. So God answered my prayer again. So now, okay, back to the plane. I'm on the plane. All my three bags are on the plane. And I said, Lord, thank you for solving all my problems. I really thank you. When I flew into Taiwan, the plane for Manila had just taken off. I was stranded in the Taiwan airport. I had three bags. I had $22 because I had bought a toothbrush. And I had no means. And everyone had left it. And I was just standing there in the middle of this big room. And I cried out to God. And I said, God, you are all I have. What am I going to do? Please help me. Guide me. I trust in you. And then God put it into my mind that 3 months earlier, we had been in Taiwan. And I remembered we'd stayed at the Paradise Hotel. And I remembered the face of the driver. And I thought, well, maybe he's going to remember me because I'm married to a Chinese and I'm blonde. And maybe he'd remember us. And so I went out with my three big bags to the curb. And there was the transport for the hotel. And I saw the driver. I told him my story. And he said, it's okay, Diana. You come to the hotel and we'll see what we can do. And so when he talked to the manager and I talked to the manager, God touched the heart of the manager to say, you can stay in the hotel. You don't have to pay. You can pay us in Manila. So God worked out that miracle again. But that night, I'd been able to make a call to Manila, collect, and the helpers had told Peter that I was stranded. So some friends came to take me out for dinner. You see, I had no money, right? So God provided dinner for me for free. And then I slept. And the next morning, I was able to get on the flight to Manila. But when I sat on the plane, God was not done with me yet. And then he spoke to me. I was really exhausted, but I was excited to go home. But God spoke to me, and he said, Diana, do you want to know why I let you go through all those trials? And I said, well, yes, Lord, I'd really like to know why. And he said, well, when you were single and you were traveling with the Crossroads with Campus Crusade for Christ, you trusted me for everything. You trusted me for all your needs, for your airplane fares, for your hotels, for your food, for your apartment. You trusted in me. But he said, when you got married, you transferred your trust from me to Peter. And you looked to him to supply all of your needs. And he said, I allowed this to happen to you because I want you to remember that I am the source of all your needs, that I will supply all of your needs. I am the spring that never runs dry. I use different people. When you were single, I used your supporters to supply your needs. Now that you're married, I'm blessing Peter, and he's able to supply your needs through my blessings. But I am the spring, and I wanted you to remember that you are always to trust in me and not to forget that. You know, I cried and I said, Lord, I am so sorry. You are so right. Yes, Lord, I will always trust in you. And can I tell you that I never forgot that lesson. I know today that no matter what blessings I have in my life, no matter what source it seems to come from, that actually all blessings are from God and that God will supply all of our needs in Christ Jesus. He is faithful. God bless you all.
Praise God. Isn't it so true that we have a tendency to transfer our faith from God to other things? Perspective. Is God faithful? He's faithful. Now, God will always teach us many things. My lesson is I will not let my wife travel alone. But praise God. God is more than able. God wants us to have godly perspective. To have godly perspective simply means you need to develop that habit of putting God in the center. Learn to see how God sees things. It's not automatic. If you don't know God, you don't know His promises, you don't know His word, it's impossible to have godly perspective. And that's why I encourage people, read the Bible. It's almost the end of the year. I'm not yet done with reading the entire Bible this year. Remember, every year I go through the Bible? So I will do some more reading between now and December. But my prayer is I get to know the Lord more. I get to know His promises. So that when I encounter problems, I will see things from God's perspective. Not man's. Not my ways. But His ways. Is God amazing? Yes or no? Praise God. Now, let's look at Joseph. What is his perspective? Not only on trials, but what about prosperity, success? Now, therefore, it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his household and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Look at his perspective. Our position comes from God. Our authority comes from God. For Joseph, it's God. God has made me a father to Pharaoh, lord of all his household, ruler over all the land of Egypt. You see, for Joseph, success is stewardship. For Joseph, position is stewardship. You and I are given a lot of blessings. They are never meant for ourselves. God gives it to you, and God is saying, I'm entrusting this to you. Your position, your job, everything belongs to the Lord. And once you have that perspective, you will begin to use your influence wisely for the kingdom of God. You begin to understand it is not about your agenda, it is God's agenda because of your perspective. And the Bible tells us Joseph understood this. Look at the next verse. He said, hurry, go to my father, say to him, thus says your son Joseph, God has made me Lord of all Egypt. Come down to me. Do not delay. You know why? Because Joseph understood to be blessed is to bless others. Look at his understanding. I will provide for you, for there are still 5 more years of famine to come. You and your household and all that you have would be impoverished. Meaning, God entrusted this to me, so I will take care of you guys. Until you begin to realize everything belongs to the Lord, you will not be a good steward. I know many of you became successful from the bottom up. You work hard. And if you are not careful, you have this mindset. Success is because of my hard work. It's because of my ability. Listen to me. That is not true. You have your part, but ultimately it is God who brings success. Yes or no? And if you understand everything belongs to the Lord, including your business, then every single centavo that you spend is a spiritual decision. Everything you do with your time, with your family, is stewardship. Now, I grew up in an environment where we are very thrifty. I guess that's the Asian culture. We are very thrifty. My blood is made up of Chinese blood and Ilocano blood mixed with some Jewish blood. You understand? So when it comes to money, you know, when people were teaching about tithing, sabi ko, tight. Tight yan, tithing. Anong tithing, tithing yan? Tight. Then I learned everything I have belongs to the Lord. That changed my attitude. You see, a generous heart comes from a right perspective. If you know everything belongs to the Lord, and you know that God gives you a promise, if you are generous, you will never outgive Him. If you understand the theology of giving, the theology of ownership, your life will be different. If you have a financial problem, your attitude is different. You say, Lord, this is our problem, but it's really your problem. Lord, how do we solve this? You will not think of cheating. You will not be thinking of compromising. I remember years ago, my son was applying for a development permit. Now, this is a problem in this country, graft and corruption. But I praise God because my son learned to trust the Lord. Understand? No, we are not perfect, okay? But this is a lesson. The governor told my son, that mayor will never give you a permit because that mayor is under me. And the property you are developing is my opponent. Then my son said, yeah, but I already bought it. No. As long as I'm governor, you will never get a development permit over my dead body. Now, what do? If you are a child of God, a businessman, Do you panic? No, you don't panic. Because you believe that God is in charge of everything. Amen? That God has authority. Well, you know what happened? That governor, in less than 1 year, he died. No, seriously. And then the mayor called us. Patay na si Gob. Mag-apply ka na kagad. Friends, you have a God who is all-powerful. But many times, He allows problems. He allows delays. Why? Because God is more concerned with our character development than in fulfilling the desires of our heart. You know why? Because God is after our character. So when you have bosses in front of you, ahead of you, and they don't want to approve your request, if I were you, I will just pray, I will relax. Look, when the news was heard in Pharaoh's house that Joseph's brothers had come, look at Joseph's understanding of authority. Pharaoh heard about it. You know what Pharaoh did? Amazing. Joseph settled his father and his brothers and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt, in the best of the land, in the land of Ramses, as Pharaoh had ordered. You see, Pharaoh ordered Joseph, you take care of your father, you take care of your brothers, give them the best. Joseph understood authority. All authority comes from God. Joseph learned to submit to authority when he was a boy. He respected his father. When he became a slave, he respected the authority of his master. When he became a prisoner, he respected the authority of the jail warden. When he became the prime minister, he respected the authority of the king, King Pharaoh, because Joseph understood this amazing principle, which I pray you will all understand, especially young people. Young people, read this together with me. Everybody then. Every person is to be in subjection to the governing authorities. There is no authority except from God, and that which exists are established by God. All authority, parental authority, husband authority, family authority, employer's authority, church authority, the Bible says all of this exists because of God. And what's our part? Every person is to be in subjection. Now, the biggest problem, why will I submit to this authority? The people are corrupt, the people are unfair. Listen to me. Rome was unfair. The Roman government is not exactly just. But Paul told the believers, do not have a revolution. Submit to the authority. You know why? God is bigger than those in authority. Amen? Yes or no? Look, the Bible tells us, the king's heart is like channels of water in the hand of the Lord. He turns it wherever he wishes. God is able to overrule human authority. In fact, all kinds of authority, government, parents, husband, employer, spiritual leaders, listen to me. Wives, I'm talking to you now. Wives, do you respect the authority of your husband? Do you submit to your husbands? Ladies, louder. Not loud enough. Children, listen to me. Children, do you respect and submit to the authority of your parents? Yeah, that's good. That's a wonderful kid out there. You know why? Yes, wonderful. You know why? Because you know for a fact authorities are given for our protection. I learned this years ago. It's called the umbrella of protection. You submit to authority. You know, years ago, when I was a young boy, I loved guns. You may not know this, okay? I love guns. And my father told me, you are too young to have a gun. Well, when I was in high school, I kind of maneuvered my way, and he got me an air gun. And we went hunting with my classmates. It's a powerful air gun. You know those pellets? And when I lifted the gun for lunch, I did not know it was fully cocked. Boom! It hit my classmate on the head. And he fell down immediately. What's the problem? That classmate of mine was the son of the principal. I rushed him to the hospital. We x-rayed immediately. Praise God. The bullet just kind of, you know, it's pellet, so it kind of went through. It did not go inside. It just bounced off, right? But he collapsed. I was just thinking, what if I did not listen to my father? I insisted on a real gun. You know what would have happened? Newspaper headline, student Peter Tanchi, murdered. I mean, it's really awful. You see, submission to authority may not be pleasant. You may not know why, but it's there for our protection. So, singles, listen to me. If you are courting your girlfriend and you are tempted to a premarital sex, look at your perspective. If you believe that the Word of God is to protect us, when God tells us not to have premarital sex, when God tells us to protect our sexual purity, if you have the right mindset, you will say, you know what? I will honor this girl because it is for her good. It's for my good. It's all about perspective. If you have wrong perspective, you're going to have wrong thinking. And you are going to make wrong choices. And then you're going to have wrong behavior. My friends, perspective is everything. It has to be grounded on God, who God is, His authority, His power, His love for you. Are you convinced God is good? Louder, right? God is good. All the time. Sure? All right. Hallelujah. Is God good? Praise God. And the Bible tells us, He sent His brothers away. As they departed, He said, do not quarrel on the journey. Look at this amazing experience of Joseph. He was after his brother's interest. He said, okay, mag-away-away. You know why? For Joseph, he understood how God can change lives. Can I make a long story short? What happened to the brothers of Joseph? You know what happened? God used trials and problems to transform his brothers also. Remember this chart? How are we transformed? God's Word and God's Spirit. Yes? What does He use? What kind of people? Difficult people. Turn to your neighbor like you. Now, circumstances. God uses circumstances. What kind of circumstances? Difficult circumstances. Time. Short time, long time. Long time. Do you know how long? What I'm going to read to you is 22 years later. Joseph met his brothers again 22 years later. You now discover in Genesis 42, I'm backtracking. You know what Joseph did? God gave him wisdom. Joseph put all of them together in prison for 3 days. Why did Joseph put his brothers in prison? God gave Joseph the wisdom to love his brothers, but to love does not mean sentimentalism. Love means you balance truth, love, comfort, character. You know, in prison, what those brothers went through? In Tagalog, natauhan. Natauhan sila. You know why? While they were in prison, God spoke to them. They said to one another, we are guilty of concerning our brother because we saw the distress of his soul when he pleaded with us, yet we would not listen. Therefore, this distress has come upon us. Notice, while they were in prison, they got a taste of their own medicine. And finally, God spoke to their conscience. Listen to me. For 20 plus years, the brothers tried to remove the memory of what they did to Joseph. They were probably living in denial. They were refusing to acknowledge what they did was wrong. But can I tell you something? Your conscience is a powerful tool of the Lord. God will wake up your conscience. The brother realized, my goodness, we are guilty. To bless the brother, you don't bless them materially only. You got to bless them spiritually. We are guilty. What else? Concerning our brother. Why? Everybody read. Because we saw the distress of his soul when he pleaded with us, yet we would not listen. In other words, you see the heart of Joseph. Joseph must have cried when his brothers betrayed him. He must have been pleading. Huwag po, huwag po. Their heart was hard. They didn't care. But in God's time, after 22 years, God changed people. You know why? Reuben, the eldest, said, in Tagalog, sinabi ko na sa inyo, did I not tell you? Do not sin against this boy. You would not listen. Now comes the reckoning for his blood. You see, time changes people. sometimes you need to realize it is not you who can change people. Who will change people? Louder. God. Is God capable of changing people? I tell you, God is good. I don't know how He does it, but entrust God, entrust people to the Lord. In His time, He will do it. And you know, make a long story short, Joseph had another plan. He wanted to test the brothers, if they really changed or not. And do you remember what he did? I hope you are reading your Bibles, okay? Don't just read it on Sunday, okay? Read Genesis. Joseph set up a plan. Joseph said, you put the silver cup in the camel of Benjamin. Why? Because Benjamin is the favorite now of his father. He wanted to see how his brothers would react. So, when they said goodbye to Joseph, they were going out. Joseph sent a group of soldiers to check, why did you steal the cup? And the brother said, of course not. We did not steal the cup. And then the brother said, you search us. Whoever will steal the cup, he'll become a prisoner and he will die. No problem. So they began searching from the eldest down to the youngest. Where was the cup found? In Benjamin. And when Benjamin's camel, the cup was discovered, if you're the brothers, what will you do? If you were not changed, you know what you will do? Remember, Benjamin is now the favorite of Jacob. You know what the brothers would have done? Tama nga. Sige, patayin mo na yan. No. The brothers were no longer jealous. The brothers changed. You know what happened to them? All of them cried. All of them said, oh no, this should never happen. You know why? Look at what they said. They tore their clothes. Each man loaded his donkey. They all went back with Benjamin to see Joseph. You know why? People changed. And look at their statement. Judah was the spokesman. Judah said, what can we say to my Lord? What can we speak? How can we justify ourselves? God has found out the iniquity of your servant. Notice what they did 22 years ago. They are saying, this is payback time. Sabit kami. Behold, we are my Lord's slaves, both we and the man and the one in whose possession the cup has been found. Joseph and brothers are saying, don't take Benjamin along. All of us will go to jail. All of us. Why? God changes people. From selfishness, from jealousy, they now think of Benjamin. And more than that, they now think of their father. Look at what they said. When he sees that the lad is not with us, my father will die. Thus, your servants will bring the gray hair of your servant, our father, down to Sheol in sorrow. No. You must restore Benjamin. In Tagalog, kami na lang sa jail. But let Benjamin go home. You see, they change. People do change. But who can change us? Answer? God. So, look at what Judah said. Judah said, please, let your servant remain instead of the lad, a slave to my Lord, and let the lad go up with his brothers. You know what Judah did? Judah was the one who betrayed Joseph. Remember? He sold Joseph. But look at his statement now. He's saying, let all of them go. I will take the place of Benjamin. Do people change? Yes. Who changes people? God. How big is your God? Perspective. At the end of Genesis, what do you discover? Joseph's perspective is amazing. Joseph told his brothers, you meant evil against me. God meant it for good in order to bring about this present result, to preserve many people alive. Look at that perspective. You, people, you meant evil against me. You see, God holds people responsible. People may have evil plans. And God is saying, I know, they're evil. But, praise God, but, everybody read, God meant it for good. the power of God to override human foolishness. How big is your God? My God is so amazing. My God is all powerful. He can override your mistake. He can override the mistakes of others. Why? Because God is God and you are not the Lord. And you know what Joseph said? His perspective on blessing? I am blessed to bless you. Therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you, your little ones. He comforted them and spoke kindly to them. We are blessed to bless others. As we close, let me tell you the story of a young girl who got so frustrated with problems. It's like your daughters, okay? She came to the father. Father, I'm tired of solving problems. Every time I solve one problem, comes another one. After I solve my problem with my classmates, there will be another problem. I'm tired. The father is very wise. The father said, baby, come with me to the kitchen. And the father began to boil water. And as he boiled the water, he separated the boiled water into three containers. In the first container, he placed carrots. In the second container, he placed eggs. In the third container, he placed the coffee beans. And then it was boiling. And the daughter said, Daddy, what has it got to do with problems? The daddy said, you watch. After the boiling was over, he said, notice all of them went through similar affliction, hot boiling water. But look at the carrots. He said, the carrots are hard, strong. But after boiling water, I call this kamote, but it's carrots, okay? After the boiling water, what happens to the carrot? It becomes limp. It becomes weak. Some Christians are like that. They're strong. When they encounter trials, they lose their confidence. They lose their faith in God. They become weak. They become limp. He said, look at the egg. Oh. He said, the egg inside is soft. Yes or no? But after boiling water, the outside looks the same. But the inside is hard. And he said, many Christians are like this. After going through trials, the outside is still the same. But the heart has become hard. And some of you have become hard inside. Cynical. And he said, but look at the coffee. He said, after the boiling water, what happens? It transforms the environment. The aroma is released. And now you have coffee. He said, Christians should be like that. You change your environment. You don't become a victim. You become a victor. You become a blessing. My friend, that can only happen if your perspective is right. If your perspective is wrong, there's no way you'll respond properly. You can become weak, you can become hard, or you can be a blessing. As we close, look at this amazing chart again. Godly perspective will produce what? Godly thinking. Godly thinking will produce what? Godly choices. Godly choices will produce what? Godly behavior, and godly behavior will produce a godly legacy. Next week, I'm going to close the idea about Joseph, about his godly legacy. In the meantime, let me ask you, how's your perspective? Are you having problems today? How will you respond? I pray you will develop godly perspective. Apart from Jesus, I don't know how you can ever develop godly perspective. Apart from a personal knowledge of who Jesus is, what he did for you on the cross, it's almost impossible. So may I suggest, I'm going to close with a word of prayer. And those of you who need prayer, as they sing, come forward. I'm going to ask the pastors and their wives and the prayer partners to come up and pray for you. But in the meantime, I'll give you a chance to really pray to the Lord. Perhaps some of you are hurting. You are discouraged. You have lots of problems. Can I pray for you? But more than that, I want to pray for those who do not have a personal relationship with Jesus yet. Let's bow our heads. And you can pray with me. Now, before I pray for you, how many of you would really like to have a personal relationship with the Lord? You said, you know, I really don't know the Lord yet, but I want to know Him. I want to develop godly perspective. Will you raise your hand? Wonderful. Anybody else? You say, I want to really come to know the Lord. I need this godly perspective. I want to have Jesus. Raise your hand higher. All right? Many of you. Okay? Bring them down. Pray with me. Okay, pray this prayer. Lord Jesus, I don't have godly perspective. I don't really know You. This afternoon, I want to know You. I humble myself before You. I realize You died on the cross for my sins. You have proven Your love for me by dying on the cross. Today, I invite You as my Lord and my Savior. Come into my life. I surrender to You my problems. Give me a godly perspective to see things from Your point of view and not from my point of view. I surrender to You. Thank You for coming to my life. In Jesus' name we all pray. Amen and amen. Thank you. If you need prayer, please come up. May I ask the pastors and their wives and the prayer partners, we have prayer partners here, prayer warriors, just come up here as they sing.
Let's sing this last song. Let's give thanks to God. for the first time, we would like to invite you in the Welcome Center.
God bless you.